Listening Library presents Girl Stuff by Lisi Harrison. Read for you by Holly Linneman. This novel is for you, dear listener, because girl stuff is hard. Be kind to each other and find the funny in everything. This is also for Luke and Jesse Harrison, even though they will probably never read it. Don't get me started on boy stuff. Chapter 1. Fonda Miller glued a picture to her vision board and smiled a little. It was a half-staff smile that, if texted, would require two emojis, since it felt happy and sad at the same time. In the picture, she and her best friends, Drew Harden and Ruthie Goldman, were lying in a heap on Fonda's front lawn, laughing themselves breathless. It had been taken 2 months earlier, back in June, moments before five heartless parents ripped them apart. They had been so upset about saying goodbye for the summer that they tied their ankles together in protest. While they were tying, Fonda's mother, Joan, had tried to convince them the 8 weeks would fly by. Then Drew's dad chimed in from the driveway next door.
The separation will be healthy, especially since you'll be going to the same school when you get back.
He's right, said Mrs. Harden. Nesties need breaks every now and then. Drew rolled her hazel eyes, probably because she couldn't stand when her mother combined words. Why can't she say neighbors and besties like a normal person? Drew snorted, which made Ruthie and Fonda laugh harder. And Ruthie's parents, well, they were at work, wrapping things up before their family road trip to Washington, D.C. But if the Goldmans had been there, they would have said something like, Poplar Creek is beautiful, but there's no culture here and even less diversity.
It's important to leave our sunny Southern California bubble and explore the outside world.
That was the kind of thing they always said. Learning was their cardio. The parents were only trying to help, but their words couldn't fill the pit of loneliness inside Fonda's stomach. They couldn't make long summer days fly by, and they couldn't bike to town for frozen yogurt. They were nothing more than verbal band-aids, well-intended distractions that never fully stuck. So, with their ankles bound together by a worn skipping rope, Fonda, Drew, and Ruthie took big, stubborn strides toward the top of their cul-de-sac. Goodbye, Poplar Creek, and hello, someplace where grown-ups let nesties spend summers together. Someplace with free froyo and unlimited toppings. Then, thunk. Within seconds, they fell out of step with one another and timbered onto Fonda's front lawn, and they were separated the next day. Now, 2 months later, Fonda couldn't wait to see them again, and she doubly couldn't wait for them to see her new, ultra-sophisticated flat-ironed hair. Only three more sleeps.
Joan, can we stop this now?
Asked Winfrey, Fonda's older sister, who had recently started addressing their mother by her first name. The 16-year-old was standing over the kitchen table, scissors dangling from her fingers like an old handbag.
I'm getting vision bored.
She had gotten her driver's license earlier that day, third time's a charm, and thought she was all that. But when a girl has cactus green eyes, butterscotch-colored highlights, and three number one surf trophies, she kind of is.
More like vision blurred,
Amelia said, rubbing her baby blues for effect. At 14 and a half, she had her own equally intimidating brand of cool. Tall and lithe, she was a fierce beach volleyball player who managed to pass swimsuits off as clothing, though it was her fiery auburn waves and statement sunglasses that made her a fan favorite. Then there was Fonda. Petite, flat-chested, and secretly loving the whole back-to-school vision board thing. The paper scraps, Chinese takeout boxes, and glue smells made her insides tingle with delight. Or maybe Fonda was tingling because, for the first time all summer, she wasn't feeling her friends' absences the way one feels the hollow churn of stomach upset. She wasn't angling to be included in her sister's plans or scrolling through Insta, hearting everyone else's hashtag good times while she watched and rewatched Netflix original movies. Tonight, the Miller girls were hanging out together. Tonight, Winfrey and Amelia were not calling Fonda a tag-along. Tonight, she was a belong, just like them.
Honestly, Joan, Winfrey said, biting into a dumpling, why do we have to do this?
Vision boards help us identify our goals, Joan said, with the patience of someone who hadn't already explained it twice.
And why do we need to do that?
If you can't visualize them, you can't manifest them. Amelia began tapping the screen of her phone.
There's gotta be an app for this.
For what?
Manifesting goals.
Joan swiped the phone from Amelia and stuffed it in the pocket of her overalls. No screens. Manifest with your hands. It's more rewarding.
Hey, Amelia, why don't you put a picture of a vision board app on your vision board? Fonda joked. That way you'll get one.
No one laughed. Instead, Winfrey gripped her belly and groaned,
Rumble in the jungle. Can I be excused?
Same, Amelia said, with a teeny smirk. I think the Mushu chicken was bad. They hurried off, giggling, leaving behind two anemic vision boards, one with a crooked photo of a tropical beach and the other of surfers hanging out around a bonfire. Most moms would insist they come back to the table, but Joan, a feminist studies professor at UC Irvine, encouraged freedom of expression, even when the expression didn't deserve to be freed.
Did you eat bad chicken too?
Joan asked Fonda, offering her an out if she wanted one. Fonda shook her head, because really, what else was she going to do on a Tuesday night? The odd jobs that kept her busy all summer had ended, which was fine. There were only so many babies to sit, dogs to walk, and hours a girl could spend working at the community pool snack shack before she lost her marbles. But Drew and Ruthie wouldn't be back until Friday, and school didn't start until the following week. So, yeah, Fonda was on board, pun intended. Besides, her sisters weren't exactly begging Fonda to fake food poisoning with them. As always, they were probably planning to sneak off to a secluded beach or some cute boy's house. And, as always, that plan did not include her. It wasn't that they didn't like her. It was that they didn't have much need for her. In their eyes, Fonda was still a baby. It didn't matter that she had just turned 13 and was less than 2 years younger than Amelia. Until Fonda's body made a woman out of her, her sisters would keep saying things like, a little privacy, please. Or, this conversation is rated MA, for mature audiences only. They'd speak in whispers and lead their friends into rooms with doors that slammed shut. They'd beg Fonda to do their chores when they had their periods and forget to thank her. Their lack of regard hurt like 1,000 ear-piercing guns to the heart. When Drew and Ruthie were around, it hurt a lot less. But even then, Fonda couldn't shake the desire to get her sister's approval. Luckily, Amelia was starting high school, and Fonda would finally be the only Miller at Poplar Middle. Boys wouldn't ask her which beach her sisters would be at over the weekend, and girls wouldn't ask where they shopped. All questions directed at Fonda would be about Fonda. There would not be an older, cooler version of herself roaming the halls. For once, Fonda would be the Miller who mattered. Maybe she'd finally even earn the attention of the Avas, the only girls at Poplar Middle that Amelia had ever talked to. Fonda couldn't help but wonder what made three girls with identical names and personalities so special. They never once even glanced at Fonda. They were so busy laughing and tossing their effortless waves. By 9:30 that night, everything Fonda wanted in seventh grade had been pasted into place. Yes, her feet ached and her paper cuts stung, but if manifesting goals really worked, Fonda would be so busy dominating, she'd forget about her sisters forgetting about her. For starters, she'd finally belong to a friend group. Her friend group. No more drifting from one squad to another or scrambling for a seat at lunch like she had to in sixth after Maddie and Kaya, her closest elementary friends, transferred to private. From now on, Fonda's seat would be saved, and if she didn't show up, two people would notice. The Avas would no longer seem to have it all, because Fonda, Drew, and Ruthie would actually have it all. For the first time ever, they were going to the same school, and they'd show the Avas what true.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.